The nets are down and the champions named. In a trying year, the annual college basketball tournaments offered a welcome feeling of the familiar. The Baylor University men won their first title, and as Amna Nawaz reports, it was the women of Stanford who scored another big win.
Stanford's win over Arizona on Sunday came down to the final seconds of the game and a single point, with a final score of 54-53. It marked the team's first NCAA championship title in nearly 30 years, further cementing coach Tara Vanderveer's place in sports history, now the most winning coach in women's college basketball. But it also capped a difficult season during the pandemic. COVID restrictions in their home county of Santa Clara forced the team to live on the road for weeks. And just before the men's and women's NCAA tournaments kicked off in March, a long list of deep disparities came to light, from less reliable COVID tests for female players to an embarrassingly sparse fitness room compared to the men's facilities.
This is our weight room. Let me show y'all the men's weight room.
The NCAA apologized and upgraded the women's workout room, but it didn't escape national outrage, including from Coach Vanderveer. In a statement, she called the differences, quote, evidence of blatant sexism.
And Coach Tara Vanderveer joins me now. Coach, welcome to the News Hour. And firstly, and most importantly, congratulations. How are you doing today?
Thank you very much. I'm doing great. I kind of woke up and you have to remind yourself, you know, we're national champions and it feels great.
Well, let's talk about that championship, because before this, you have won national titles before, right? Two of them. But the last one was a while ago, 29 years ago. This win, after this particular year, especially in the pandemic and everything you've been through, what does this win mean?
You know, it might have an asterisk by it because of, you know, kind of the COVID championship was a little bit different. It was in a bubble and everything. But in some ways, I think it was the hardest championship, you know, to maintain. Your health, number one, with all the issues that are going on and the challenges of that. For this particular team to be out of Northern California for, 10 weeks about, I think the hardest thing, honestly, was not going home for Christmas. How we survived that and stuck together, I think, is a real testament to the resilience, the determination, the passion, of the young people on our team. And I'm very proud of them.
When it came to the tournament, of course, a whole nother conversation was sparked after some of those deep disparities between the men's tournament and the women's tournament were just revealed for all to see. There's sort of this idea that there's been a pervasive sense of less than for the women. And you yourself said that this looks like blatant sexism. This is evidence of that. But you also call this moment a watershed moment. What did you mean by that?
Well, I hope that this is not going to get swept under the rug. You know, we're living in a time where, we're really evaluating everything. We're evaluating, whether it's, how police work with communities. We're looking at, all the different viruses, not just the COVID virus, but the virus of racism, the virus of sexism, and how that is pervasive in our world. And basketball is just a microcosm of our society, but to serve, to dumb it down, to serve hot dogs to the girls and steak to the boys, my parents would not do that. And hopefully in, other families, people have to look and say, this is not right.
The NCAA, of course, as we reported, did apologize. And under pressure, they opened their books when they were trying to explain why the budgets for the two tournaments are so different. And they basically said, look, the men bring in net income more than the women. What did you make of that response? Is this all about the money?
I don't think it should be all about the money. On the conference level, our football does bring in more money than any other sport. In terms of the tradition that they've had, the head start that they've had in being competitive and being on television and the promotion that they get every day. And, whether it's on podcasts or, in the newspaper. But what women's basketball, what's kind of interesting actually is with social media, women and women's sports are the ones that are being fouled by more people. And I think that looking to the future, You have to evaluate what you're doing. And yes, they do bring in more money. The television contract is bigger, but does that justify what they've been doing?
Coach, I got to ask you, we mentioned you are the most winning coach in the history of women's basketball. So I'm curious, in all the games, when the tournaments and you came not quite there, you almost won it, but you didn't. What kept you going year after year?
One of my favorite coaches was a coach, Pete Newell, who won an Olympic gold medal, won an NCAA championship. He coached at Cal, actually. But, you know, he's just like, the game is overcoached and undertaught. I want to do a good job teaching the game of basketball. And I get pleasure from watching the improvement of my players. But it is fun when you do have a team that is at this level and you win it. And, you know, it is motivating. And I hope that it motivates our players to, you know, work hard in the offseason and become the best players they can be.
Coach Tara Vanderveer, thank you so much for your time. Congratulations again to you and your team.
Thank you very much. My pleasure.